Jesus' name, amen. So I actually have not preached on Reformation for years because I always make the interns preach on Reformation so we make sure that they're Lutheran enough to be ordained in the future. It's the same reason we make them preach on Trinity Sunday to make sure they're not heretics. So this year it seemed that it wasn't going to work with intern Meredith because we know she's not a Lutheran. It's never going to be one. All right, so where are all the baptized as infant Lutherans, the lifelong Lutherans in the room? All right, very good. The rest of you can take notes now if you want to. So it's a day that we celebrate our heritage as Lutherans, which of course started back in the 16th century. Martin Luther was a dedicated monk. He tried to live fully into what was the Catholic system, I suppose, the way that they worked, the understanding of being justified. The Catholics, if you were formerly Catholic, you'll remember this, had a two-tier system or a two-sin system. Original sin. Jesus covers all of that. You are good to go there. All the original sin, absolutely gone. Everything else, you're responsible for. And the way that you pay for it is penance, going to Mass, doing acts of charity, confession, all kinds of things like that. And in Martin Luther's time, you could do it with cash. It was called an indulgence. You get a little slip of paper, and it gets you out of purgatory ahead of time. In fact, John Tetzel, who was the quintessential medieval salesperson for the church, had this saying, whenever a pfennig or a penny in the coffer rings, another soul from purgatory springs. Tetzel said that indulgences were more efficacious, that is, they did more work than even the cross of Christ. Now, Martin Luther tried to work that system as best he could. I mean, he said at one point, if anyone could have been saved by his monkery, it was I. He had this loathing of God. He had hatred towards God because he said, God has set the bar far too high for any of us. I can't possibly live up to that. And so I know I'm bound for hell no matter what I do. So he had this hatred for God. And in a sense, a hatred for himself. Until he was working on a commentary in the book of Romans. You discover those passages in Romans 1, 17 and 18. It said, the righteous will live by faith, that there is now righteousness that exists apart from works of the law. And Luther in that moment said, I felt as if I'd been born anew. There you go. Lutherans are Pentecostals, even if we don't speak in tongues on a Sunday morning. I felt as if I'd been born anew. He said I was filled with this sweet love of God. It changed his complete understanding. It changed everything for him. And so then he went about teaching the faith. He did it in a couple ways. One, he translated the scriptures into German because he knew the people have to read this. They have to understand this. They have to come to know it as I've known it. And then he used hymns, group sing, to teach the faith. The Mighty Fortress, a great example of that, taking what was a common melody of the people and making it into something that teaches the faith. It's kind of like what I do, and Kyle does it as well for the 10:30 service. We take rock songs and then we write different words to them. So if I were doing the 10:30 service this week, I would do my version of A Mighty Fortress, which is written to AC/DC's TNT. Jesus Christ, he's dynamite. I know, not quite the same as orchestra and choir. I kind of like it, though. It's fun to do, and Scott rocks on it. So he wanted to get the message out to the people. The other thing he did is made a catechism. He talked about how everyone was ignorant of the faith, and he said, especially the clergy. Good God, what ignorance I found. So he wrote an easily understood exposition on the faith, which when I was in confirmation, we had to memorize. I'm amazed I'm still in the church. That was such a horrible experience. And the only thing I still have committed to memory is the explanation to the third article. I believe I cannot by my own reason or strength come to my Lord Jesus or call on him. But the Holy Spirit has called me by the gospel, enlightened me with his gift, sanctified and kept me in the one true faith. I think I only remember that one because it was the last one we finally had to do. And then we were finally admitted to the communion rail. You might remember this as a child. You didn't even come up for a blessing. My parents would go to the rail, leaving three very imaginative children in the pews. My mother's way of going to the communion rail, she would walk like this and she'd look. And she'd walk and she'd look. She'd walk and sometimes she'd point. I'm so glad we now invite children up to the rail. We had young children today receiving communion because there's no barrier between a child and God. And communion shouldn't be a barrier. In fact, Martin Luther said, the only thing that makes you worthy of taking communion is by believing that it's for you, that God invites you forward to be a part of that. Now, we always need to say as Lutherans that while Luther had some things really right, and we should praise him for the things that he understood, even though he was incredibly embarrassed that we call the church Lutheran, he got a lot of things wrong. In fact, if you read Luther, in many ways, he's especially towards the end of his life, becomes very spiteful, mean-spirited, unforgiving. And then in light of what happened in Pittsburgh, he wrote horrible things about the Jews that the Nazis ended up using to justify the slaughter of men, women, and children. He said horrible things about the peasants in the peasant war, which allowed the Lords to go and slaughter them, men, women, and children. So as much as he understood grace, perhaps, from himself, he didn't understand that it extended far beyond his imagination. I went to seminary in Bexley, Ohio. It's a Jewish community. So we had a Lutheran seminary in the heart of a Jewish community. I took a class called The Holocaust, The Agony of Theology. We immersed ourselves into Holocaust history until you just couldn't bear it anymore. The only thing we had to do was write a paper on the meaning of God in light of the Holocaust. And then we put on a Kristallnacht service, the night of broken glass, in our sanctuary. And the way that we did it, we invited the Jewish community to come in and be a part of this. And as we spoke the name of every one of the death camps, we took a bag with glass and we broke it so you could hear the sound of it in that darkened sanctuary. At the very end of that service, I heard a man behind me just say, "Oy vey." Could hear the pain in his voice. But on that Lutheran seminary campus, in the heart of a Jewish community, there was a coming together, a forgiveness and unity. So there's this beautiful, beautiful statue that remembers and honors those who lost their life in the Holocaust. Luther got some things right. He got other things horribly wrong. He is, as we say, a saint and a sinner. Being a Lutheran has changed over the years. A lot of things are different. I'm going to be doing a funeral on Saturday for a member of one of our charter families. It's Jeannie Turgeson, Archie's daughter. Cecil Turgeson and Fran were the ones that I knew here. Cecil, who went by Turgey, if you came the first time, he'd always greet you in Norwegian. Because he was proud of his Norwegian heritage. So at one time, Lutherans were very, in a sense, ethnic churches, right? You had the Norwegian church, the Swedish church, the German church, and they had their customs. Now, Turgey, every single year of my ministry, while he was still alive, tried to get me to go down to the Gap for the Lutefisk Festival. I'm grateful to say I avoided it every year. And Pastor Eric, who is German, always wanted to go to the Wurst Festival, right? We don't have that same kind of feeling anymore, as we can see from Pastor Kyle's podcast, To Hell with the Hot Dish, that we don't identify necessarily anymore with our heritage, but rather what makes us Lutheran. The first Lutherans were known as evangelicals because they said we're about the good news, this good news that shapes us and changes us, this good news that we're called to proclaim to the world. Luther never wanted to be called Lutherans. Evangelical is who we are, which means that we're called to be out and about and share the good news of Jesus Christ. The other things that have changed are the way that we look at the things we do. We are a church of word and sacrament, but for most of my life, sacraments didn't happen very often. Maybe once a quarter and then once a month. I think it's a great thing that we're doing it every single week. In fact, if we look at our last three hymnals, those of you who might remember the red hymnal, you had to jump over the end of the service if you wanted to do communion. The green hymnal moved the end of the service back so that you had to jump over communion to get to the end of the service. The cranberry hymnal doesn't give the option. We're having communion. When I first came to the rail as a young person, I thought it must be something incredibly special because they're making it so hard to get there, to memorize things, to pass the test. There's something up there. And I got there and I was so frankly disappointed. I was like, is that it? All that work? Now, communion for me is a mystical moment. It's no longer about just me and God repenting of my sins and that kind of individualized moment. No, it's a communal moment. When we eat and drink the body and blood of Jesus Christ, we are joined with Christ. Therefore, we're joined with each other and we're joined with everyone who's gone on before. My grandparents. My father is at the rail when I commune. It's as if the heavens open and the saints in light are all around us. And we experience the beauty of the future, if only for the briefest of moments, so that we then can stand up and go out with good courage and live our lives with faith. This is a mystical moment. I want to end with two things my son Joshua said when he was just a little boy. He was 4 years old. Victor, wherever he is, he keeps moving. Victor was in the hospital on Christmas Day. He'd been in the hospital a lot. We thought that was going to be it. Really did. Had already planned the funeral. So I brought Joshua with me to the hospital. He was wearing a little Santa suit. The nurses were all over him. He'll be in therapy the rest of his life. He was playing in the corner when I got out my communion kit and I went to take the wafer and I was going to give it to Victor. I was going to do the words of institution. I was holding it. And Joshua grabbed it and he pushed it at Victor. And he said, "This is Jesus' bread. Eat it." I said, "Victor, those are the words of institution." There was healing in that meal and in the medication that was developed. But more than that, a healing of the spirit and the soul. The words of a small child who understood something about communion. This is Jesus' bread. Eat it. Last thing I'll say about him and the story is that I was teaching at the Lay Academy on Lutheran identity. I had brought Joshua with me. He was probably about 5 at that time. And he said, "Daddy, what are we doing here?" I said, "Well, Joshua, I have to teach a class on what it means to be a Lutheran." And Joshua says, "I know what it means to be a Lutheran." I said, "What is it, Josh?" "We're the people that like God." And why do we like God? Because God loves us. In confirmation, we have a little saying to kind of teach that. The question is, what did you do to get saved? And the answer is nothing. Second question, what will you do now that you know you're saved? The answer is everything. We're the people that like God. Because God likes us. To that God be all glory, honor, and praise, now and always. Amen.